Hey folks, it's Glenn with the Cactus Atlas, and today I'm in Arizona and we're going to be exploring the remnants of one of my favorite cultures, the Sinagua people. Well, it's a Sunday and I wanted to make a video. I was in the mood to do something and I wanted something that we haven't done in a while that's not too far from the Phoenix area. And I thought about this place, Montezuma Well, that we're currently at, Montezuma Castle. Huge tourist spots if you've ever come to Arizona. Chances are you've visited these places, especially Montezuma Castle. But it's been a couple years and we have not documented this in 4K, so I thought it was about time that we head back, now that we're armed with more knowledge than last time. So our first stop on this tour today of the Sinagua culture is something that I'm not even quite sure if it's Sinagua in its origins, or if it was influenced by other cultures that live in this area. It's a remnants of a pit house. Come check this out. So this sign gives you a little bit of information about what we're looking at. Here's an artist rendition of what this would have looked like prior to the excavation, when it was in its full glory. And you can see all of those little holes that we're looking at were certainly for support structures. So that's precisely what we're looking at, are where the little poles would have gone back in the day. Excavation of this began in 1958, according to some of the signs, and you can see early on someone hard at work excavating this here. And there was an entryway to the structure that they're talking about that was directly across from us. So I presume that was the entrance for how you got into this thing. This may have been, I'm not sure if this was built by the Sinagua people or the Hohokam culture, which also was in the nearby area of Phoenix, an ancient culture that is no longer around today. And the sign surmises, is this the influence of those people? Was this a mixture of cultures living in this area? I don't know if we could ever really know that anymore, but that's what this is. What's fascinating about this is more representative of structures the Hohokam would have built in this area around the same time. And they're not quite sure if this was just like a family home or a place of gathering, like where farmers in the area, old farmers, would have met for ritualistic purposes or who knows what. But regardless, evidence of human occupation of the past. Okay, so let's get deeper into this here, this our starting point, Montezuma Well today, because while this is fantastic and amazing, it gets better from here, trust me. So let's go. So for those of you that know Arizona geography and you know where Interstate 17 is, this is right off of that, as is the Montezuma Castle. This is a subset of Montezuma Castle, but they're miles apart. They're not far from each other, but they're right off of the interstate, making it really easy to stop and see these things.
And here we go. Montezuma Well. So just giving you a little look here at your options of what you can do. Perhaps my favorite thing to do here is to actually walk down this trail, the Swallet Ruin, where you're gonna see some cliff dwellings down there. Kind of see some people down there. And you learn a lot of fantastic things about this well, how it exists, what it is, as well as another gem that I'll show you when we get down there. One of my favorite things to seek out here. But do remark, I mean, this is a very arid, dry place, Arizona. To find a perpetual water supply like that down here would be a godsend, to say the least, although there's something slightly poisonous about what we're looking at down below, so more on that as we explore here. And there is more of what we would expect when we come to see the Sinagua culture, these cliff dwellings, like right here on the side of the well. You can see several out there, either granaries or residences, I'm not sure.
So the well's a really interesting geologic feature. It's one of the signs mentions here, the water itself takes 10,000 years to percolate up here. It's actually the result of snowmelt from 10,000 years ago up on the Mogollon Rim, which is a feature, I don't think we can see it from here, but it's not far off and we've seen it on the channel. It's the end of the Colorado Plateau. So all this water just flows down from snowmelt underneath the ground and percolates back up here. And this used to be a cave. This is a sinkhole now. But at one point, this would have been all underground. All right, let's go down to the depths
and see what we can learn about this well here, Montezuma Well. A couple things I can tell you right off the bat is it's interesting is that this isn't like a typical water feature with fish and like a really alive biological ecosystem down there. Very little can live in the water due to the very high carbon dioxide content, and I hear arsenic also. So there's very few creatures that can actually live in this thing. Let's come out here, watch where we're stepping here, and come to the edge and see what we can see. If we see any critters or anything at all here in this very quiet, still water source. The reflections are beautiful. Really neat to think too that, you know, if we could rewind before the time of Columbus, before America was discovered by the Western world, to see what kind of sites we would have seen here 800 years ago, 1,000 years ago, the different cultures that lived in this area, how they survived, how they actually made use of this, to see it all in action would be quite the thing. All right, we're kind of making our way down to the main attraction down here, and maybe I got the place to myself, so I can tell you another really cool story and thing that I find fantastic about this area. So down here you see caves, and you're not allowed to enter them, understandably so, but you get a really good close-up look at these dwellings, which, by the way, depending on what time of the year you come here, you may not be able to visit down here. They do shut it down when the bats are hibernating, and these are pretty deep caves. Pretty fantastic, I would say, to imagine what we would have, the conversations we would have heard in languages we couldn't decipher today. Right on the rocks, right next to the structure here, is this black writing, and maybe that's shoe polish or some, who knows what that's written in, maybe just like char. But that is 1800s pioneer graffiti from a pioneer photographer named George Rothrock. So Rothrock has got stories in and of his own. He's worth doing a whole episode on, in my opinion. I think he came out to the Arizona Territory, I want to say the 1860s maybe even, in a very dangerous time where there were a lot of hostile tribes in the area, the Apache, the Yavapai. And Rothrock documented those times. He's taken pictures of Vulture City, and he actually took a picture, I think, of that view right there using a technique called stereography, if I remember that one correctly. So Rothrock is from the time where I think his father was an early pioneer that was coming back and forth throughout the West, and then he kind of followed his footsteps out here before Phoenix was even really a big city. This would have been back in the time of Henry Wickenburg mining at Vulture City, where Rothrock would have entered here to Arizona. One of the earliest pioneers we can think of in this area that's not like Spanish, that was with the Spanish Empire. So really early Arizona history, and someone that thankfully documented it for the ages, kind of like how we are right now. And he's not the only one that left his mark. There's this guy, Duke Heflin. If I'm reading that correctly, that's 1896. That would have been maybe 20, 30 years after Rothrock's presence here, but still, more 1800s graffiti, also 1896. And yet another cool feature to read about down there is like basically the mechanics of the well, how the water flows and bubbles up from the bottom of the well, then it drains out. Over here on the side, it recycles about 10% of the water each day, and it takes about 7 minutes for water to percolate through this area and out the side over there on the other side, out to a creek on the back. And the natives use that as an irrigation method back in the day, which is really super cool. So that's the next thing we're gonna go see, is we're gonna go back up to the top now and walk down to see if we can access that area. We started over there, we're making our way around the rim of this thing, and we were right underneath my feet eventually at one point when we were looking at Rothrock's graffiti, and the drainage hole where the well drains out to the creek is somewhere underneath our feet and kind of goes underneath all this earth and lets out down there in that creek. It's worth crossing this side anyway, just for the view of the dwellings on the other side. And this is where they talk about the dwellings and how they would have used ladders or just scaled the cliff face to get out to those little nooks and crannies. You could even see other ones if you look carefully, like the careful stonework. So I imagine over time there were more that must have crumbled. Like this, you can actually see some that they built on top here. This looks like a much larger structure. Not much remains today, as with a lot of these things out here in the Southwest, covered by overgrown bushes and shrubs, but I imagine this would have been quite a sight, and maybe where more of the folks lived.
And all around this landscape, and out in the area beyond, there's a place out there called Sacred Mountain where another really large pueblo was built. I can see it. It's going to be hard to point it out to you here, but you can see there's so much evidence of the past all around Arizona still, from voices that can't tell their stories anymore.
I already see the feature that I wanted to come show you guys. Do you see this little man-made canal here? Well, who do you think's responsible for that ingenuity? Okay, so I'm trying to draw back on my memory back to maybe 2019 or so, when Amy and I came down here and visited. I actually put my feet in the water at the urging of a ranger who said it would have been okay. And back then you could actually walk up there. So I see the damage. I think this was not flowing down this a ways, I don't think, back then. But basically this is where the water comes out of the well.
This is an amazing thing to think about. Number one, think about this well, this sinkhole kind of on the other side of this, water draining out of that right here. 10% recycled per day. That water took 10,000 years to get into the thing, and then finally let out here after 10,000 years. Amazing. The geology is pretty cool on its own, despite the human history here.
And the fascinating thing about this is this canal. Canals like this all over the Southwest, perfected by cultures like the Hohokam, did this so they could transport water miles away from here to irrigate crops like corn and probably squash and poison ivy. Not really. No, I wonder, after the water seeps through and comes out here, is it free of the arsenic? Is it oxygenated? Is it drinkable by people and animals? This I could not tell you. I don't remember, or I never read a fact about that. So if you know the answer to that, please contribute in the comments.
So now you're starting to catch on. I think there's much more than meets the eye here at Montezuma Well, and hopefully I've given you enough reasons to kind of want to check this one out, because Montezuma Castle, which we're going to see up next shortly, is amazing on its own, but this really is the perfect accompaniment to like a day trip. You can make a day trip out of the two easily, a half day maybe even. So we've driven south now on Interstate 17, heading back towards Phoenix now, where I stopped at Montezuma Castle. This is probably the big site to come visit if you're gonna have to choose between one of the two. This is probably what most people choose, but look down there. I think that's the same flowing stream we just saw right up the road. A helpful pro tip also is that there is no fee to go see the well. You could just go right on in, and there are rangers there to answer questions, but this place I think does have a fee. So if you have a National Parks pass, that'll get you in like I have. You know, I might have to recommend, if you've never been to Montezuma Well or Montezuma Castle, maybe you would want to start here at Montezuma Castle and do the opposite of what I'm doing today, just so you can go to the museum and learn a little bit about the culture. I'll throw some facts your way as we go tour the grounds here, but yeah, this is a good museum to get some info.
After you exit the museum, there's this beautifully paved trail, so very accessible, unlike Montezuma Castle. If you wanted to come at least see one of them, this might be the one for you. But yeah, look at these really tall cliffs. This is where these folks built their dwellings. The main one that we're gonna see, it's hidden around a corner. I'm gonna do a reveal because it is the main attraction, the thing that you do come to see here. And it is quite spectacular, especially if it's your first time ever seeing it.
You know, I'm here to tell you firsthand that seeing this thing, it never gets old. Usually when you see these things, if they're not piles of rubble, just stone, barely making out the foundations, you might see stone, but usually not with that outer veneer on it like that. So one thing to maybe address really quick is Montezuma Well and Montezuma Castle, kind of a curious name, because as many of you guys have heard before, there was a Mexican, the emperor, warlord, chieftain, Montezuma. And this has nothing to do with that. It was just the jolly people of the 1800s attributed some structure like this to Mexican Indians or natives building this when it had actually nothing to do with Montezuma. So there's one of your facts of the day. So I'm pretty sure I haven't mentioned it yet on this video, but maybe you speak Spanish and you might recognize the name of these people, Sinawa, the Sinawan people. It's a Spanish word, or two Spanish words, that mean without water. Sin, without water, agua. And that's not what these people would have called themselves. I don't even know if we could know if what they ever called themselves or what their language sounded like. But that was really a name given by early Spanish explorers who were looking for water up near the San Francisco Peaks and Flagstaff, which are all volcanic mountains and not really good for having natural springs, so they called it the mountain without water. And these people, the Sinawans, have places all over northern Arizona in the area that I'm in, and they just gave that name to the people that lived here, which is kind of ironic after we just looked at Beaver Creek and Montezuma Well to say without water, that's debatable. So they usually have like a ranger or a volunteer telling good information about who these people were and what they were doing out here. But over around the side here, there's this diorama that actually shows you, I think, a cross section of what the inside of this thing looks like. So I always like to come look at this thing really quick before fully admiring the structure that remains today up on the hill. Some facts that I heard the ranger talking about while I was standing out there is that there's 4,000 square feet of space in that overall structure. And you can kind of see a cross structure here. There's an audio program you can listen to if you like. It's hard to not get the reflections, but this shows you what life would have been like, including like the nervous mom chasing her little one saying, "Don't jump, don't jump." I think that the dwelling up there was a combination of like living quarters and storage, probably granaries, things like that. They probably primarily slept up there and spent most of their time outdoors farming and hunting down here at the bottom, but probably would have slept well. Another interesting thing to ponder is, based on where this is facing today, you get the sun here in the afternoon in the winter time that would make this nice and warm, help warm things up in the colder months and help keep things cool in the summer, according to what I read in there. So maybe they built it up there for the climate control. Maybe they built it up there to escape floods, people, who knows? But there's probably many reasons to want to live up there. In fact, there's a picture inside the museum, I think from the 1920s, where you see like an old Model T and you could actually see ladders that went up there. And I think I even read, kind of did a blow through today, but I think they used to let tourists go up there way back in the day. They don't let that anymore. There's in fact no more ladders up there. And the ranger was saying that occasionally rangers will go up and check for damage, for falling rock. Apparently there has been damage over the years, but one of the interesting facts that the ranger over there said is that it's 90% original. And you can actually see the lighter colored mud towards the back and the top. That apparently is original, and the redder color was from the National Park Service helping to restore it somewhat. But there has been some restoration on this thing, but it's really cool to think that a lot of that is original. And I can imagine from all the way up there, these people would have heard that sound of the stream much of the year, as we can hear it right now. It is a raging river right now. But other than that, it's just very peaceful in this late afternoon light out here at the base of these cliffs. One pro tip is certainly the castle proper is really the main attraction here, but there's actually some remnants of something that used to be on this side that I think was larger than that structure that has some interesting history around it that I've read. So back here, you can kind of see people hanging out up there looking at foundations. This would have been, I forget how many rooms, but this whole area would have had a similar structure to what we saw at the main castle, but it burnt down. I think they found burnt embers of stuff. So it either burnt down, I think they may even have found a body with that. So they don't know if it was like a ritualistic burning. Maybe it's a sign of hostility. I read a university paper that I found a long time ago about that theory, that maybe these people were in fact at odds with other cultures that were coming into the area. So the sign does indeed indicate that this was burned. That's how this got destroyed, but it was a five-story structure. You can kind of see some of the notches in the walls where the wooden poles would have gone. So this thing would have been bigger than the main structure we saw out there. It's really hard to fill in with your mind though, looking at this thing, what it would have looked like.
This is known as Castle A, and just like the sign over there says too, this whole area suffered a lot of looting throughout time. Those cultures were fascinated with around the turn of the century, the 1800s, were not very respectful when they came to visit places like this.
Make sure you don't miss Castle A. It's worth just coming down the few extra feet to check it out. It's not going to add a lot of time to your itinerary for sure, but definitely easy, really fascinating to think about. Why did it burn down? You know, I was thinking our theme today is certainly the two Montezumas, Montezuma Castle, Montezuma Well, but very much so water. The reason why these people were here. The big mystery with all of this stuff, with all these cultures, is nobody really knows what happened to these people. It's generally thought that some of these cultures, like the Hohokam, just evolved to be some of the modern tribes we know today, like the Pima Indians, and the Sinaloa are thought to have evolved into the Hopi. And to support that evidence, one thing they show inside of the museum are examples of basket weaving between the Sinaloans and the Hopi. And the interesting thing is the weave is exactly the same. They use the same styles in their pottery and weaving, giving evidence that maybe that is true. All right, folks, there you have it. Montezuma Castle and Montezuma Well, a double dose of Montezuma action here in the beautiful state of Arizona. The next time you're in these parts, this is not to be missed.